I'm going to be reading to you from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, as we continue our study of the Gospel of Mark. This is Mark 1, 9 through 11. And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened, and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This is the point in the Gospel of Mark, when Jesus has come down to the Jordan River out of his hometown of Nazareth up in the hill country to do as all the rest of those did in those days who worshiped God in spirit and in truth, he came to be baptized. We looked last week at much of what the Bible had to say about John the Baptist himself. We saw that he came at a time of great expectation, of great messianic expectation. This was about 30 years after some amazing events had happened in Bethlehem and Jerusalem. It had the whole nation talking at that time. Magi had come. They had turned Jerusalem upside down with their talk about a new king on the throne of David. A great star had shone over Bethlehem. Shepherds had testified of hosts of glorifying angels in the skies. Herod the Great had slaughtered the children of Bethlehem to kill the Messiah or any talk about him if he could. But people certainly remembered those things. And if a baby had been born then and had survived, he'd be of age now. And there had been different people to come and go claiming that they were the Messiah, and they usually ended up dead by Roman or by Jewish hands. There was also, at the same time, some 30 years before, an amazing birth to the elderly wife of an old country priest. He was struck mute by the angel Gabriel in the temple. This miracle son, John, now 30 years later, living in this time of expectation in Judea, was out preaching repentance and the imminent arrival of the Messiah. John preached in the spirit and power of the prophet Elijah. All the good people of the countryside, many from the great city of Jerusalem, came to hear him, and many repented of their sins, and they were baptized by him. And into these crowds one day walked this humble carpenter from Nazareth. Now, it's possible that these second cousins, they were second cousins, John and Jesus, they might never have even met before that day. Likely enough, at least not since early childhood. In his first couple of years or so, Jesus was away in Egypt until the death of King Herod. Mary and Joseph returned to Nazareth. John's elderly parents, Elizabeth, the cousin of Mary, and Zacharias the priest, they were living in a town of Judah. They might have died while John was still a boy. They were old. He is thought to have joined the religious colony of the Essenes out in the desert regions, which were far to the south of the hill country of Galilee, where Jesus lived, south of Jerusalem, south of Bethlehem, all the way down near the Dead Sea. We are told by Luke about John, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit and was in the deserts until the day of his showing unto Israel. Now, about Jesus' childhood, we're not told a whole lot, not until he reaches 12, which in the Jewish tradition was an age of accountability for a boy. I've wondered why we don't know a whole lot about Jesus before then, why we don't have a lot of stories. There are some traditions back there, but none that merited the kind of dignity, truth, and respect that we have for Holy Scripture. I have a feeling it was so that mothers would be saying, well, you know, Jesus didn't do that when he was a boy. You know, we don't want our children growing up resenting Jesus. as an eldest child and one who was an extraordinarily good boy. I didn't have to get disciplined very often. I was an extremely good boy. My brothers and sisters still resent me to this day. That's not quite true, but I want to tell you what we do know about Jesus as a child at the age of 12 in Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 52, and let me read them to you. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast, and when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance, and when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. And he went down with them, and came to Nazareth, and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Well, one sermon after another could be preached about all of that. We're not going to do that today. We are going to look at it a little bit before we reach a little bit of understanding about what was happening as Jesus came to be baptized. This story of his childhood was suitable for Holy Scripture, and we've discussed why that was. Jesus refers, Luke refers to the parents of Jesus here, Mary and Joseph. Now, Joseph was a stepfather to Jesus. In every legal and in every real life sense, Joseph was a hands-on, engaged parent of Jesus. Now, as we know, as we see in today's society especially, it doesn't take all that much effort to become a baby daddy, to father a child, but to be a genuine, emotionally attached parenting Abba father or daddy indeed is a lifetime commitment, and Jesus knew very well in his childhood the strong, protective, nurturing guidance of a father, and was provided for materially, emotionally, and spiritually by a man who would show him what a daddy, what an Abba father should be. Joseph, the husband of Mary, the stepfather of Jesus, might have been the most underrated man in the whole Bible when you think about what he had to do. Joseph and Mary had raised Jesus right, and they knew he was a good boy. He was a smart boy and could certainly be trusted to be on his own. It took them some time to realize that he wasn't even with them in the caravan that was headed back up to Nazareth from the Passover, and they turned around and began looking for him. Now, in my childhood, and I know many of you are the same way, way back in the 1900s, before there were cell phones and all of that, you know, me and my brothers, we could be trusted to ride our bicycles with our friends and head off to hike way out into the woods. We explored miles out into the hills and the forests and all of that out there. We'd take sandwiches and Cokes, and we were expected to be back by supper, or at least by sunset. And we had to be called in after dark as children. Mom had a cowbell. Did any of your parents resort to that kind of thing? How embarrassing. You'd hear it for blocks and blocks and blocks, and everybody in our neighborhood knew it was supper time at the Gardner house. And one or more of the kids was just out too late when you could hear far away, clang, dang, 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 and we'd be called in like cattle. Nowadays, we hardly dare to let our children out of our sight You know, especially in the cities. Back in my day, parents didn't have to fear the kind of society that we have today. In that day and time, amongst a caravan of Jewish families of Nazareth, a little small town in the hill country, everybody knew everybody returning from Passover, Mary and Joseph weren't really worried until some time had passed. They finally realized Jesus wasn't with them, and they panicked like any parent would. And they didn't have 911 to call. There wasn't any Amber Alert that they could resort to. They had to run back to Jerusalem on their own, retracing their steps, hoping not to find their boy on the side of the trail. They returned all the way back to the temple, and of course that's where they found him. Now, I'm not sure how it happened that Jesus was still there days later, talking with the learned rabbis and teachers. We proceed knowing that it was innocent enough. Now, maybe Joseph didn't hear Jesus say something like, "I'll be right there. come and get me when you're ready to go." You know, maybe Joseph didn't hear it. I'm sure if we could ask Mary, as good a man as he was, it was all Joseph's fault. I'm pretty sure of that. The rabbis, meanwhile, for those days that this boy was in the temple with them, were astonished. They were watching him listen intently to their teaching, understanding everything that they said, answering their own difficult and puzzling questions with a wisdom that must have indeed seemed, and certainly was, supernatural. There he was, 12-year-old boy, at the age of accountability for the Jewish tradition. This was the age at which a boy begins to become a man. The choices and decisions he makes at this time of life affect the decades to come in a way that little else ever does. Jesus had decided, Jesus had chosen at 12 years of age to be in his father's house and about his father's business. Perhaps among the rabbis there that day was old Hillel the Elder. They still talk about him today in the Jewish tradition. He was one of the greatest rabbis of all time, and he would have been living his last year right about then, when Jesus was 12 and in the temple. Now, certainly his son, Simeon ben Hillel, was there, also a great teacher, and his great-grandson, or his grandson, who was a great teacher, Gamaliel. You've heard that name before if you've studied your Bible. Gamaliel, he was a great teacher. He was called the beauty of the law by the Jews. He taught so much about the grace of God out of the law of Moses. This was a fellow who was very close to the kingdom of heaven, and he was well beloved by the Jews in that day. It is no wonder that this gentle rabbi, according to tradition in the first and second century church, was himself one of the secret disciples. He was the one who defended the church in the Sanhedrin against his own great student, Saul, who was terrorizing and seeking to destroy the church. He later became the Apostle Paul. But you can see how Jesus, about his father's business at the age of 12, speaking to the learned doctors and the best rabbis there in Jerusalem and them marveling at him, there is a boy on the threshold of manhood. His presence on that day may have had a lasting effect on those great teachers. In fact, you can be sure of it. At 12, a Jewish boy would have also become an apprentice for some trade. And we know that Jesus was not only the stepson of Joseph, the carpenter of Nazareth, but in time he himself became the carpenter. Joseph is not mentioned. He is presumed to have passed away by the time that Jesus leaves Nazareth. Mark 6:3 reads in part, "Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and of Judah and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" They knew him as the carpenter there in Nazareth. Jesus was working in a trade. There's nothing wrong with that. There is nothing wrong with a man or a woman using their hands and using their skill to earn a living. And as a side note, I think that we should be training up more of our children in that way today. Many a person new in the faith is tempted to believe that they are destined for great things. And maybe they are. But the temptation that appeals to one's ego, especially when you're young, and it's a twisting of some truth, because everyone who is born again in the Spirit of God is a new creation in Jesus, and we are destined for glorification and greatnesses that we can't even imagine. But the temptation is to choose to believe that what we imagine about the course of our lives is what God intends for us. And it would be very easy for a boy at the age of 12 to have his head turned when the greatest scholars and teachers of Judea are astonished at what you have to say. Perhaps they were mindful years later. It was just 12 years after old Simeon and Anna there in the temple had stunned the crowds prophesying over a baby boy. He'd be 12 now. Maybe they wondered if that astonishing 12-year-old was not that infant who was born in that time of signs in the heavens and great trouble. It certainly could have been tempting for a 12-year-old boy in a circumstance like that, with these amazing rabbis saying how astonished they were at him. Maybe he could have thought that he would stay and begin an amazing career as a child prodigy, a great teacher and leader of Judaism. We saw what happened with Paul. He was a very young man, a genius under the name of Saul, and as a young man, he nearly destroyed the church. That kind of thing can happen when a young head is turned. Someone who is young and talented or skilled, whether it's in something like basketball or whether it's in something like mathematics or something, it's very easy for a young mind to be turned and to think much more of themselves than they should, to think of themselves as great, not to think of God as great who has given them the gifts. The Father's business for Jesus and for each of us on one day might not be the same the next day. Jesus knew that the business of his Father for him was to be apprenticed to Joseph, to learn the trade of carpentry, to serve others with the skill of his hand, with the sweat of his brow, with the diligence of his labor, with the integrity of his dealings. His Father's work for Jesus for the next 18 years was to help provide for his family. His Father's work for Jesus for the next 12 years was to be the head of that family after Joseph was gone, to provide until his brothers could take over. Being about his Father's business meant Jesus needed to do as all other young people should do, and humbly learn and work and mature. Most studies show that the rational part of the human brain doesn't mature until at least the age of 25. Further changes continue to happen to the brain, they say. In some people, maturation continues until 30 or even 40. Of course, I've met people in their 60s and 70s who might as well still be in high school. Jesus was faced with all the temptations in his childhood that we faced. Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." Jesus was faced with all the temptations of youth. I know what temptations there were in my youth. I can only imagine what there might have been in Nazareth, in the hill country of Galilee, getting drunk, throwing rocks at the sheep. I don't know, what do you do to misbehave as a boy in Galilee? I'm sure they came up with something. I'm sure they were just as inventive then as we were in Butler, Alabama when I was a child. All kinds of ways to get into trouble. Even though I was a relatively good boy, I still figured out how to get into trouble. It wasn't all that hard. Jesus did not give in to the temptation to sin even once. And that's amazing. He lived with his family among the people of Nazareth, learned a trade, worked for them as a carpenter, waited until God let him know that he was mature enough now to set out upon his great ministry. The time came at last when Jesus was still young. Looking out over this audience and looking at myself in the mirror, I think 30 is young. He was still young, but now he was mature. He was loving, he was learned, he was patient, he was wise in spirit, he was strong of body, he was nimble of mind, he was learned in scripture, he was experienced in life, and fully prepared to face the holy destiny that prophecy and God's word had ordained. Now, for all that, Jesus proceeded in humility. As we are told in Matthew 3, 14 and 15, but John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. Jesus did not skip John's baptism into repentance. In the same humble spirit, Jesus later washed the feet of his disciples like a slave, so that they would never hold themselves any higher than that. Jesus and no one else earned the miraculous thing that happened next. When he came up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened up. Now, we can't really imagine what that was like, looking through the veils of time and space into eternity to see the holy throne of God and he sitting upon it who created all things. It would burn out our unworthy eyes and blast us away into nothingness. But not Jesus. Then came down that most peaceful of images, that of a dove fluttering down as the Holy Spirit of God and alighting upon him. And then to seal this eternally significant moment into the souls of all the believers who were there came words like thunder out of the heavens in the voice of the Almighty Father. Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. His old life was washed away, even though it wasn't sinful like ours. When we go through the baptism and we symbolize the washing away of the old life, Jesus' old life wasn't sinful, but it was left behind. His preparations were complete. The new life that Jesus was entering into was one of complete mature service to God. The things of childhood, even the perfect childhood of Jesus, were now left behind. The days of listening and learning and growing and apprenticeship. Now, Jesus began his work after 3 decades of sinless preparation, being about the business of his Father, the ministry of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, began. And this mission was to defeat hell and death, to redeem all the elect who choose to follow God. In our faith, we are to be as little children, but in our work, we are to be as mature, sober-minded men and women, living out our lives, going about the business of our Father in heaven, following Jesus, being known for our love for one another, bearing the fruits of the Spirit of Almighty God. Our mission each day is to take up the cross. Our mission each day, our business each day, is to sacrifice our own sinful desires to follow Jesus into glory, that glory that he saw when the heavens were opened up to his unworthy eyes. You see, one day, we who are born again will close our eyes, and then the next time we open them, we will be gazing into that glorious vista of eternity. We will see then what Jesus saw when he was raised up by John out of the River Jordan. And we must certainly know that we will not be burned or blasted away by the sight of it, because God will hold us worthy because of Jesus Christ. We can know our Father's business in our daily lives. And that's mainly to do all those things that we know in this life we should be doing. Loving one another, caring for one another, praying for one another, learning God's word, becoming more like Jesus each day. That's our business. And taking that gospel to the uttermost parts of the world, and we're nearly done with that.